Good morning, church.
Di macaroni kereke.
Want to thank the choir for the beautiful piece of music.
Koto dolivwa kereke choir inga limbo la vudiolu.
And the song simply says, "Stand like a brave."
Luri limbo imani no kwata.
Exodus chapter 4 verses 1 to 3 reads as follows.
Ibale angorali Exodus chapter 4 verse 2 and 3.
From verses 1, 2, and 3 reads as follows. Moses answered, "What if they do not believe me or listen to me?"
Aku Moses, nitakuyini loko banganimfumeli, banganiyingiseli
vanhu. And say, "The Lord did not appear to me."
Vaku vanhu lava, xikwembu xizangi xitivonakarisa ka wena.
Then the Lord said to him,
aku xikwembu xikuka yena,
"What is that in your hand?"
Shana ikomeyini abokweni ra wena.
Then he replied, "A staff," he replied.
Mushe ahlamula aku nikome nonga.
And then the Lord said, "Throw it on the ground."
Aku yilahleli hasi.
Moses threw it on the ground.
Mushe alahlanonga liya.
And it became a snake.
Yajika ya hunzuka ivanyoka.
And he ran away from it.
Mushe atsutuma aichava nyoka liya.
The life of Moses is a very interesting one. He lived exactly 120 years in his life. The first 40 years of his life, we know he was born the son of a Hebrew slave. We know he survived and was rescued and saved. We know he was adopted by Pharaoh's daughter. We know that in the first 40 years of his life, he was given the best education Egypt could ever offer to him. In keeping with the Egyptian tradition, he wasn't tutored by anyone else, but he was tutored by the retired military and political leaders. So he was given the first good education the first 40 years of his life. Actually, if this question was asked of him, "What do you have in your hand the first 40 years?" The first 40 years, he would have said, "I am Moses, the learned one in wisdom of the Egyptians. I am Moses, the mighty one in words and in deeds." He would have said, "I'm the son of the greatest queen of Egypt." If this question was asked in the first 40 years of his life, he would have said to God, "Why do you even ask? Because I'm the next in line on the throne. You know I'm extremely knowledgeable and I have so many expertise in my life." Because Moses was well talented, was rich and famous, and great artistic abilities. But God is very interesting. He did not ask him the first 40 years of his life. He asked this question in the last years of his life. When this question was asked of Moses, it was when he was 8 years of age. And at this time, my dear friends, Moses had come down in his life in terms of age. He looked a little bit scared and skimmish, and he stuttered a lot. At this time, he was prepared for the journey ahead. But he did not know that the Lord was going to send him to go and relieve the children of Israel. So the question, "What is in your hand?" was a very interesting one. And Moses simply answered, "I have a stick or a rod or a staff in my hand." And this stick was an ordinary stick. It was not a crown.
crown.
He wasn't carrying it because he was a king. It was an ordinary thing. But you know, ordinary things, they turn into greater supernatural things when they fall into God's hands. We know it turned into a snake. We know that this stuff also, he had used it before on the plagues on Egypt. We saw also he used a staff when he was pulling through the way for the Israelites to leave the Red Sea. We know that also he used a staff to provide water in the desert. We also know that he used it for heading the ship. There was nothing special about it in the hand of man, but powerful when touched by the Creator God. The stick became something wonderful, my dear friends. What we learn from this is that God is never limited or terrified by our lack or needfulness. He says what you have right now is exactly more than what I need of you. Let me tell you something. It was Samson. He used a jawbone of an ass. And he destroyed the enemy. The victory was not in the jawbone. The victory was in Jesus. What about the widow of Nain? The prosperity of the widow and her sons was in the pot of oil in her house. But it was not limited there. It was God himself who gave her food that never stopped from day to day. It is the small things in life that you have that you don't care about that end up being the greatest thing that God can use. You remember what Moses used to cure the water from being bitter? The tree that would cure the bitter water of Mara was in the wilderness itself. The things that God wants you to use, they are not somewhere else, they are in you right now. Ruth had cleaned grain, from the field. David had a sling and stones. The named boy had 5 loaves and 2 fishes. The woman had an alabaster of oil. You see, my dear friends, the Lord will show you your pot of oil, your rod of deliverance, and your jawbone of victory. If you'll only ask him, you will receive the revelation for your elevation today in Jesus' name. And the question is this morning, what is it that you have in your hand? Are you like Moses? Are you stammering in your lips? Do you feel that you have inadequate education? Do you feel that you don't have money? Do you feel that you have a dysfunctional background? Is your shady past a hindrance to you? A shady past? Is your diseased body a problem at the moment? Are you weak in your demeanor? Are you a person who is timid? God is asking you a question this time. What is it that is in your hand? You know what? I'm telling you something. What God has given you, nobody can take it away from you. And we never realize that. We contest about things that are about us. But we forget what God has given us. Can I remind you what God has given you? Rather than dwell on the negativity in your hand right now, why don't you concentrate on the positives you are holding and the negatives will disappear? One of the things that God has given you and I is faith that cannot be shaken. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the sons of Pharaoh's daughter. So God has given you this great faith that you are in today. There are many who would kill to be Seventh-day Adventists. Keep the faith as strong as you can. Remembering that faith is the victory. That faith recognizes that beginnings are always scary. But if one endures until the end, the benefits are
greater.
The faith that God has given you defies common sense. For what is impossible with man, it is possible with God. The faith that God has given you declares, God has brought me thus far and he will surely lead me all the way. Sometimes you can't see the future, but faith tells you that someday it will pop up. For the God who controls and orchestrates and conducts the future has guaranteed it to you. So what do you have in your hand? God has given you the beautiful faith of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Take that faith the best as you understand it. And go and share it with others and God will bless you in a special way. What do you have in your hand? You remember, I've chosen not to speak about the money and the clothes and the things that you have. I am not talking about those things. Those are material thing. I'm talking about immaterial things. Things that when you have, nobody can take away from you. What is it that you have in your hand? You have the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. While our sins are high as the mountains, and as deep as the ocean, God's grace is measureless. That's what God has given you. Every minute we spend this side of eternity is filled with God's undeserved and unmerited faith, grace. If it
would
be removed from us, we would be hopeless and lost. Value the grace of God that he has given you. Remembering that it is God's grace that loves us at our worst. That accepts us at our lowest. And keeps us sane at the worst hour of our madness. That's what the grace that you have in your hand that God has given you. May I remind you, my dear friends, this morning, that you have in your hand God's grace which deals effectively with your past failures.
It
gives you courage to face today's challenges with so much confidence, knowing that we are loved in spite of our shortcomings. That's what the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ does to you. And something beautiful about the grace that you have. Grace that has been given to you free of charge. This grace will never abandon you. It will fight for you relentlessly until this grace presents you before the Father in heaven. And throughout all eternity, grace will remind us of the power of the love of God. That's what you have in your hand. We've mentioned faith in your hand. We've mentioned grace in your hand. You know what else God has given you in your hand?
That's what happened to you, feeling
you. That you never think that you have. God has given you what we call foresight as well. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt. That's what Moses chose. Through the foresight that we have, we are able to see the big picture. We are able to see past the darkness that we have into the marvelous light. We are able to see from the picture of sadness we have into the great picture of joy. Pass the earth into the heavenly kingdom. That's the foresight that God has given you. That nobody can take it away from you. We know that God's picture is always bigger and better for us. For he says, I know the plans I have for you. Plans that will prosper you. My dear friends, through the mind that God has given us and the
foresight,
we are able to see far ahead when things will come. The other thing that God has given us
this morning
is the power to dream big things. When
you
are a human being and you have lost your dream, you are as good as dead. God has given us individual dreams and visions that he has not given to other people. So don't lose the power of a dream and a vision that you have. Remembering that every dream fulfilled started as an idea that was pursued. Drape your mind with colorful dreams and color your journey to their fulfillment. Cherish your dreams, for when they come true, they will carry you to greater heights. That dream and vision you had when you accepted Jesus Christ. You remember you could not sleep when you had that dream. Remember, you wanted to tell everybody around you. Don't lose that dream that God has given you. What is it that you have in your hand? You've got dreams that you need to push through. Cherish your dreams, for when they come true, as I mentioned, they will carry you to
greater.
Dreams give us hope. And when they linger longer in us, everything else is forgotten and dead. When you dream, you grasp the future today, at least in your mind. So don't lose those dreams that God has given you. What is it that you have in your hand? You have freedom in your hand. God has helped you to go through so many red seas. You have walked on dry land many a time. When Egyptians and Egypt tried to drown you, you were not able to drown.
There
are always red seas in front of us and mountains on the other side. And the enemy is behind us, standing in our way. But God has placed in our what God has placed in our hands will move us forward and will
save us.
What is it that God has given us apart from money and other things? What has he placed in our hands? God has placed in our hands opportunities. God has given you many opportunities. For every challenge that throws an egg in your face, there are myriads of opportunities waiting for you.
And God is willing and able to throw a red carpet for you to walk on it. So don't fall for a temporal defeat and miss the lifetime opportunity. Know the difference that this one is passing, this one will stay forever. Remember that missed opportunities today may become our nightmares tomorrow. So we must maximize them today in order to make the rest of our journey lighter and
enjoyable.
What is it that you have in your hand? You have opportunity that are destined for eternity. If you don't know where you are headed to, you will miss the opportunity that should get you there. Remember that always, missed opportunities plus hard work gives birth to wings that will carry you virtually everywhere. What is it that you have in your hand? The last one I want to mention on this is that God has given you attitude. It depends on you how you will turn that attitude into something that will be great. We all have the right here to choose the right attitude. And if you decide to choose the wrong attitude, It will be to our own detriment. Don't envy what others have to the detriment of what you have. Sadly, we have wasted time comparing what others have as compared to what we have. Sadly, we have looked down on what we have over what others have in their hands. We have missed utilizing what is in our hands because we have been envying what others have. What you have in your hand now is enough to carry you forward. What you have now may look ordinary, but when placed in the Master's hand, it will become extraordinary and useful. The reality is that if God has called you, He will equip you. And all of us here have been called to do some work for God this year. He will help us to do more than we can ask or imagine. Theodore Roosevelt said one day, do what you can with what you have wherever you are. Don't worry about the lack of qualification. Don't worry about the lack of talent and natural and abilities. God can make you and reform you and resend you. All those in the Bible who were great, they were not what they were when God had finished with them. Look at Abraham. He was an idol worshiper before God found him. But when he turned his life into God, he became the father of many nations. From the being an idol worshipper to being the father of many, it was in his lineage where Jesus came. Where Jesus was born. Just look at David. He was an ordinary shepherd boy. But God made him the consolidated king of Israel. Just look at Joseph. Who was just but a prisoner. God made him a prime minister in Egypt. So don't look at what you are today. Cast your eyes in the future. In the future. Apostle Paul, before his conversion, was a serial killer. By association. Persecuting the church. But God made him the author of more than half of the books of the New Testament.
dzinopera half dza
Kanye Testament. Is there anything hard for God, my dear friends?
No, ndi mini zvinobhayira mudzimu
na. No, there is nothing.
Auna nachitihi.
The question is, what do you have in your hand?
Ndise ndiri wofara mini chanda chavo.
Are you willing to throw it down?
Vakotama uchirata.
Are you willing to put it to good use? Are you willing to give it into the hands of the Lord? Because when you do that, He will make a difference out of you. It's not about what we have. It's what we have given to God that makes the difference. The stick, the stuff was nothing in itself. But used by God, it became a powerful God wants to use what you have in your hand right now. Wherever you are right now, in whatever situation you find yourself today, after all, He's the potter. And you and I are just clay. If we give ourselves to Him, we can say with Apostle Paul, Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you. God is not looking for those who are qualified, as we mentioned. He's looking for those who can qualify. He's looking for yielded vessels, not perfect vessels. He's looking for those who are willing to admit and confess their weaknesses. And those who are willing to lean on His strength. Perhaps the greatest thing that you have in your hand, the greatest one that you have, right now, you have the presence of a loving Father and a wonderful Jesus in you. With Him, you can do anything. And He still loves you no matter who you are and how bad you are. He still calls you His child even now. He says to you this morning, no situation is permanent. And yours will change for the better too. He says, get up and go and excel. Remember, you are not empty-handed or God-forsaken. You are His treasure in earthen vessels. You are His treasure in earthen vessels. God will supercharge that ordinary stuff in your hand. That gift in your hand that you have. It could be the gift of being a deacon and deaconess in God's church. It could be a gift of being a chorister in the church. He says, I will supercharge it. And it will change from being ordinary into supernatural manifestation. God didn't ask for something He didn't already have. And that's what God does with all of us. When whatever I ask you to do, it means He has given it to you. Just trust Him and know that we are a miracle in Him. Know that He has endowed you with seeds of greatness. Know that you are exclusive because He has not made somebody who looks like you. No one has everything that you have. You are exclusive to Him. God uses broken things beautifully. Look at how He uses broken clouds to give us rain. Look at how he uses broken soil to set fields alight with food. Look at how He uses broken crops to yield seeds. Look at how He uses broken seeds that gives us life to a new plant. In any hard situation, if you feel that you are broken, understand that God is planning to utilize you for some great cause. My dear friends, Do not despair over lost opportunities. Just use what you have in your hand. Do not brood over your past failures. Use what is in your
hand.
Do not scared about the future that you don't know. Just use what is in your
hand.
Do not magnify or be intimidated by your weaknesses. Just use what you have in your hand. Don't just use the wait for the supernatural miracles. Use what God has given
you. Do not
be overwhelmed by your fears. Use what God has given you. Do not look at your limited education. Remember, God can teach you in 1 minute what your professor can't teach you in 50 years. So just use what you have. Do not look for unusual talents. Use what was in your hand
right
now. Do not even wish to be someone else. Just use what you have. Do not be bothered about the fact that you have a low self-esteem. Use what you have. Do not look at the bumps and bruises in your body. Those are just temporal things. Just use what you have. Because Moses used that stick in his hand, he is today the most towering figure in Judaism. He's referred to many more times throughout the Bible than Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob combined. It is his story and the story of the people of Israel living slavery in Egypt and going to the promised land that is foundational narrative of the scriptures. And somebody says, it will be difficult to find, as another person remarked, in the records of either of profane or sacred history, an individual whose character is so well fitted at once to excite attachment and command veneration as Moses, whose history is so replete at once with interest and instruction. What is it that you have in your hand? Go and use that one. May God bless you.
Thirsty
love.